Good afternoon. It's such a pleasure to welcome you to this beautiful space and to the Tanous Endowed Lecture. We're deeply grateful for the opportunity to come together and to thank each of you for being here. Tonight's program is a conversation between Jon Turteltaub, renowned film director and producer, and Dr. Jack DeGioia, Georgetown University president. More than a decade ago, Peter J. Tanous, college class of 1960 and member of the library board, established the Tanous Family Endowed Lecture in honor of Lowinger Library's 40th anniversary. Since its inception in 2010, the Tanous Lecture has featured a prestigious roster of speakers, including, among others, Dennis Lockhart, Ray LaHood, Secretary Spencer Abraham, Dr. Janet Yellen, Dr. Robert Gates, and this year, to our great delight, Jon Turteltaub. Thank you, Peter, for your generosity to Georgetown. In recognition of Peter's service and commitment to the university, he recently received the Gaston Alumni Award. As many of you know, the Gaston Award is named for Georgetown's first student, William Gaston, who in his later years as a member of Congress helped obtain Georgetown's charter as an educational institution. The Gaston Award is such a fitting tribute to you, Peter, and to your dedication to Georgetown. You bring honor to today's gathering as well as important remembrances of the meaning of this truly beautiful and hallowed space. Peter, I ask that you and your family please stand and be recognized. It's now my pleasure to introduce tonight's program. President Jack DeGioia will enter the stage with our distinguished guest and join him in conversation. Thank you.
Hurry it up, Jack.
Evidence of a misspent youth. This is a recent knee surgery, so I don't want to go into the details, but good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. It's wonderful to be with all of you for this year's Tanous Family Lecture. I, too, want to join Dean Hamasi in expressing our deep gratitude to Peter and Anne and the Tanous family for their dedication to Georgetown, for their support of our library, and for this special lecture series. Peter, it's an honor to be here with you. I'd also like to recognize Dean Hamasi and her colleagues at Lowinger Library for bringing us together this afternoon. Serving as dean of our library since 2018, Harriet has done extraordinary work with her colleagues to ensure that our library provides a home for research and exploration, stewarding 3.5 million volumes and extensive collections of rare books, documents, audiovisual materials, ebooks, and manuscripts. The Maker Hub, our hands-on studio for building and creating physical objects. Our digital archive, Digital Georgetown. The Booth Family Center for Special Collections, workshops on social impact and entrepreneurship, and lectures like this one deepen the context in which our community is able to engage the resources of our library. And since 2010, through the Tanous Family Lecture, we've had the privilege of welcoming distinguished leaders from across diverse fields to reflect on our economy, public service, energy and environment, transportation and infrastructure. And this afternoon, we have the opportunity to bring in a new perspective, the role of film in media. And it's my honor this afternoon to introduce Jon Turteltaub, an extraordinary writer, director, and producer with 35 years in the film and entertainment industry. He's responsible for a number of landmark films, from box office hits of the 1990s, Three Ninjas, Cool Runnings, While You Were Sleeping, to the National Treasure films. He's worked for many years with Disney Studios, directing major films, Phenomenon with John Travolta, Instinct with Anthony Hopkins and Cuba Gooding Jr., The Kid with Bruce Willis and Lily Tomlin, before serving as producer and director of National Treasure with Nicolas Cage and its 2007 sequel, National Treasure Book of Secrets with Helen Mirren and Ed Harris, along with Nicolas Cage. In 1999, he was nominated for a Directors Guild Award and for an OFTA Television Award for his work on the TV miniseries From the Earth to the Moon on the Apollo space program. And he recently directed the sci-fi action film The Meg, the comedy Last Vegas, and has been involved in a number of TV series as director or producer, most recently Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist. He and his wife Amy work extensively with the Creative Visions Foundation, founded by Amy and her mother, Kathy Eldon, in honor of Amy's late brother, Dan Eldon, a journalist killed in Somalia in 1993. And for more than a decade, John and Amy have supported an orphanage in Kenya and programs to protect and rehabilitate child soldiers in Uganda. Over the years, it's been a privilege for me to get to know John and his work as a filmmaker, and it's an honor to welcome him to Georgetown this afternoon. John, we could not be more excited to have you here with us, and I know I speak for all of us when I say how much we're looking forward to hearing your insights and perspectives. Perhaps no better way to start this gathering than with some short film clips. We've done a short video featuring many of John's best-known works, so let's begin with a video, and that'll give me time to get to my chair, and we'll start our conversation.
He was perfect.
Then fate stepped in.
Mister, there's a train coming!
Oh, God, you smell good.
Who are you?
While you were sleeping.
The leaning thing.
The leaning thing?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you mean by the leaning? Because he gave me flowers?
And then you leaned.
And then I leaned.
Yeah.
Okay, how did I lean when I leaned?
How were you leaning? It's a lot different than hugging. Hugging's very different. Hugging, that involves arms and hands. And leaning is whole bodies moving in like this. Leaning involves wanting and accepting. Leaning.
Hey, Luce, is this guy bothering you?
No.
Are you sure? Because it looks like he's leaning.
Thank you. See?
Cool Runnings.
So what are we going to name this sled?
Tallulah.
Tallulah.
That's my mother's name.
Tallulah. That's an option. I like it.
To do that.
Your only job is to relax.
How many times I gotta say I'm sorry?
You can't say it enough.
Knock it off.
I'm gonna go find some damn water and take all my damn pills. Then we're gonna get this damn party started.
It's this man's bachelor party! Let's
go. National treasure.
180 years of searching, and I'm 3 feet away. Of all the words written here about freedom, there's a line that's at the heart of all the others. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty, to throw off such government and provide new guards for their future security. People don't talk that way anymore.
Beautiful. Huh. No idea what you said.
It means if there's something wrong, those who have the ability to take action have the responsibility to take action. I'm gonna steal it.
What?
I'm gonna steal the Declaration of Independence.
Ben?
What an extraordinary body of work.
I agree.
Such a wide variety of films. How do you decide which ones that you want to do? How do you say no to others?
My first thing is to look for something I didn't do already, right? A lot of directors, actually most, the more successful directors, tend to do the same kind of movie a lot. And then they get called an auteur, and that's their genre and all that stuff. That always bored me, and I just wanted to do every kind of movie I've ever liked and see if I could do it. The first thing I see when I read a script is, if the script is smarter than I am, I love it, right? If I read something, who would have thought of that? That's fit. That line is great. Oh, that. And so I feel like I'm directing up, right, to that. And then I feel like I know I can do that story. I'd be good at that, and I'd want to see that. And unlike a lot of directors, I actually think about whether the movie's going to make money or not, right? Not just because, oh, look how great you are, you made, well, a lot because look how great you are, you made a hit movie, but it's just awful to make a movie nobody sees. It feels terrible. It's, you just feel like such a loser, and you want that praise, or at least that attendance after you put in all that effort. It should matter a little bit. Yeah. And then the money.
And when you've had opportunities and when you say no, what leads you to say no? Just the opposite of what you just shared?
Yeah, you know, you read scripts, you feel like you've read that script 20 times.
Sure.
Right, and you can't believe they're making that movie again. And it's, on the surface, it's very different, but it's not. And you all know, you've been to the movies, and you're like, oh, it's that movie again. There are movies that are better for other people to do. I'll read some scripts and think it's great, but I know I can't nail that, right? If someone gave me the script for a movie like Seven, I knew I wouldn't be able to make a dark, horrific, gritty, well-shot, life is horrible movie like David Fincher, who directed it, can. It's funny, my wife's the same way, is why we're married. Like, I'll be reading a script and I'll start telling her about the movie. It'll be like, whatever. The guy, he's a detective and he's looking for someone who died 50 years ago. And he meets this woman, right, who's a murderer. And my wife will say, do they get married? The happy ending. I like a happy ending.
Uh-huh. Is there something you want to do next? Is there something you haven't been able to yet try?
Yeah, you know, there is a very good possibility of a National Treasure 3 being very close and doing that again.
We didn't, you know, Georgetown didn't make it into National Treasure 1 or National, no. This, doesn't this sort of resonate with
the
you?
The location fees were too high. This would be a great place, actually, to shoot, now that I think of it. And yeah, we could find this. You just need, you know, what drove me nuts in my bad reviews for National Treasure, not that I read any of them, is when they said how fake and phony it is and how made up it is. And it's amazing how much wasn't made up. Right, we did our research and then turned what we saw into story. We didn't make up these things. We always wrote what could be possible based on what we learned, right? And those ideas came from anywhere, right? I was looking underneath Trinity Church into the basement just to see what was there, because that was the church that was there, and Alexander Hamilton's there, what's going on? And in the basement, there are crypts, these archways with coffins in them and bones exposed in New York City in Trinity Church. And in the next crypt was kids' bones. And in the next crypt was cleaning supplies. Okay? Now, if I had just done that, they said I made that up. But there was, and there's water running down the brick walls and the subway going by. So if you can tell me there's some great mystery to this library, well, there's a lot of books, 3 million books. By the way, don't be fooled by this librarian lady and the 3 million books. She hasn't read those. Maybe.
National Treasure has special resonance for all of us here in Washington. You gave Charles Carroll, the cousin of our founder, John Carroll, yes, a shout out in the movie.
Nobody knew about him. He's an important person.
How did you come to engage that?
The first thing we said was, who was the last signer to die? Because that person would take the secret with them. And we looked, and it was Charles Carroll of Carrollton. Weird coincidence. Two R's, two L's, in our research. Do you have two R's, two L's on this? Right, okay, see? And then you find out these little details and where he lived and why did he go there and how come he knew this person and all that. And then you start filling in the blanks, right? I'd never heard of Charles Carroll before any of this. I hadn't heard of most of those people, right? So the idea is to bring life to it. And especially National Treasure, my big push at first was all those great adventure treasure hunt movies. We've all seen them. We love those. Why are they always in exotic foreign places? There's an assumption that America doesn't even have history. So to find something exotic, you've got to go elsewhere. So we said, I was like, no, let's let our history be that interesting and have secrets and things like that. And the more we looked at the Revolutionary War and colonial period, every studio executive said the Revolutionary War is boring. Nobody cares about that era. Civil War, people like. Revolutionary War, snore. And all I could think of was, yes, because if you see, you all know boring teachers teach boring classes. Great teachers teach great classes. You ask anyone, what was your favorite subject? It's because that teacher was great. So I thought I could probably be a better American history teacher than my boring high school one. Movies can teach really well. We spend a lot more money on doing it. So we said, let's make it exciting. Let's get kids to love history by putting the action and the excitement and the truth. And it worked. Yeah.
The script for both.
I'm sure the teachers here are amazing.
The script is so well developed for both of those films. How does that unfold? What role?
Fighting, arguing, differences of opinions, what matters, what doesn't matter. You know, the most important part of all of this is none of that stuff, but is there a story to tell? So the story to tell goes down always to the characters. Who are these people? What's their little journey? What is they need? What's underneath it for them? What's my motivation? In a big way, because what makes us like a story is when there are stakes at hand. They can be big stakes, the world's gonna blow up, yeah. Treasure's gonna get lost, or I'm gonna feel shame. And if we can connect to a character, we're on that ride with them, and you gotta find what those stakes are. The trick with this movie is like all treasure hunt movies, we found out, they're hard and they're complicated to do because they're very linear. You go to this one, you go to that spot, you read that, you go to the thing. That doesn't make for good story usually. And the other really hard thing was every treasure hunt movie, look it up, it's probably not true, but everyone you can think of, everyone ends with the treasure being guarded by a supernatural being. I didn't know that until I started looking around. Yeah, every Indiana Jones movie. Literally God is guarding the treasure, right? There's an eight-headed monster, there's a thing. And why is that? Why? Because the writer needed a way out of this story, right? And needed an opponent the hero would have to fight who he couldn't beat, and then you're beating something even bigger than you, all that. So what do we do? So it was hard to figure out how to pull that off. And it means a lot of arguing and fighting and studio saying, you have to start shooting now, and we're not ready. And then us saying, okay, we're ready. And they're saying, we don't like it. Goes back and forth. From the time we started that movie till we released that movie was 7 years.
Wow. Wow.
That was a lot of money I didn't get for 7 years.
So how do you hold all that together? Let's focus on some of the stars that you've worked with. You saw in the clips, you've worked with some of the greatest stars in
well,
film.
Now they are.
But Sandra Bullock, Robert De Niro, Morgan Freeman, Robert Duvall, John Travolta, Nicolas Cage. How do you approach working with a star? And how do you keep that all moving over that kind of time frame?
For me, I can't speak for obviously all the directors and all that, but you folks all know. If you've ever seen a celebrity at a restaurant and you don't know whether to bother them or you do want to bother them, but it's important to you, and are they going to get mad? Maybe they're mean. That's how it is all the time. And you get yourself stuck between... And I think this kind of hit me and is, I think, important for the 11 students that might be here also. If you're intimidated and too overwhelmed, you can't do your job, right? Your job is to tell them what to do. Your job is to often say, yeah, not like that, all right? But if you're really comfortable with that and you're not intimidated, you've lost that thing that makes you want to be a movie director, right? If you're not amazed by standing in a room with Robert De Niro, you've lost the passion for it. So whatever your career, there's this little fight going on in there where you've got to be good enough to be on a par with your heroes, but not surpass them in a way where they stop mattering to you. Right? And you lose it. That's a big thing here, I would say, in Washington. Right? That goes on every day. It is much easier with the unknown 2 days in the movie player, actor, who you tell them what to do and they say, yes, please, and all that, than with the bigger stars. And the star is probably the only person on a movie who can fire you. Not because they're bigger on the ladder, but if you fire the star, you have to start over. If you fire the director, you keep going. Right? Money. So when you're always a little bit worried about saying the wrong thing to the wrong person. Also, they can be really scary. They are really scary. But let me tell you one story. Okay, so the first day on this movie, Las Vegas, right? The first day we're in Las Vegas, and the first shot of the movie is Robert De Niro, right? And so I'm nervous, I've met him, but it's Robert De Niro, he's a little weird, and he's scary, and he kills people in movies. So he's supposed to arrive at 6:30, and we're supposed to get the first shot at 7:30. We're in downtown Vegas, we have 800 extras we've paid to be there. 6:30, no Robert De Niro. Okay. 7 o'clock, no Robert De Niro. 7:30, I'm supposed to be shooting. He hasn't arrived yet. So now this isn't big budget. We just come back tomorrow. That's it. So I'm figuring how to shoot this interesting shot as a not interesting shot. Instead of Robert De Niro walking down the street and going into a casino, it's a shot of the sign casino, right? He shows up finally, hasn't gotten a haircut, which he was supposed to have gotten, so we all know that's at least a half an hour more. And the producers are standing there and they say, wow, somebody better talk to him. And I realized, you know what? I am the director of this movie. I do need him to know I'm not a pushover, that I have a vision, that we have requirements and problems that we have to... So, fine. I go to his trailer and knock on the door. His assistant opens the door, says, come in, and that guy leaves. And I prepared what I was going to say, and I said, good morning, Mr. De Niro. And I left. That was it. So in that moment, I realized I don't have what it takes to yell at Robert De Niro. I'm not going to be good at this. If he gets mad at me, I'll cry. And so we'll figure it out as we go and all that. And by the way, the producer who told me I had to go in was Amy Baer, who graduated from Georgetown in 1986. She didn't take any leadership courses, clearly. No, she's awesome, awesome. So you're constantly playing that game. There are those who don't play it and they're just really good at just having that integrity. I have the need to be liked. I want people to think I'm funny and sweet and nice because it's more comfortable for me and I feel I get more in the long run than being Mr. Mean sure. guy.
Now, your relationship with Nicolas Cage goes back some time. And he has a reputation of being a little eccentric.
Yes.
What's it like working with Nicolas Cage?
Not what I thought. And I went to high school with Nick. He was a junior. I'm older. I'm a year older, so I can tell him what to do. And we were in the theater department at Beverly Hills High School together. He was like a poor-ish kid in Beverly Hills and had a little chip on his shoulder about all that. He had a very famous uncle who was the greatest movie maker of all time, one of, and was a kind of brooding, dark, edgy kid. And I'm Mr. Happy Pants. Right? Everything's good. I'm going to make movies. Right? And so we were actually friends, but we were definitely different people. He went off and dropped out of... He didn't get the part of Tony in West Side Story, senior year in Beverly Hills High, and said, if I can't get the lead here, why am I even here? And so he dropped out of high school, took the GED, and said, I'm done with this. And the school's like, yeah, you're not a good actor. And a year later, he was starring in Valley Girl. And he would, if I ran into him, he would tease me because it was true. It drove me crazy. I was at Wesleyan doing my little theater productions and he's on the cover of GQ. Hated it. I'm a better actor than Nicolas Cage. I was. I got the part, the lead in Our Town over him. But I was a good high school actor. He was a good actor, right? The real deal stuff. But we barely kept in touch, and he's a freaking weird dude. And he's marrying crazy people and doing weird stuff and divorcing weird and buying weird things and living weird. Not unexpected from anyone who knows him. But weird is not crazy, and weird is not stupid. Right? I'm a little afraid of weird. I'm a conventional person. I like the status quo. Right? It's not very popular to say, even though most people feel this way. I like seeing what the rules are and succeeding within the world I grew up in. Other people like tearing it down or doing it a whole other way. And in life, you eventually learn all of it's awesome. There's no right way. There's no better way. There's no more moral way. It's all good if you do good work. So when we got together again, I didn't know what to expect. Was he going to be mean to me like he was in the hall that one time? was he going to... And I've seen bad Nicolas Cage movies, right? I've seen Crazy Nick with bees and screaming and eating cockroaches. And I was terrified I'd get that guy. And I wasn't sure I even wanted to do the movie with Nick. But if Nick had said no to National Treasure, the studio would have said, forget it, because we've been to so many other people. He was like, if not him, we're done. So it had to be Nick. And as of the first day on the set, on time, knows his lines, polite to everyone, doesn't ask for favors, doesn't send people on errands to help him find sandwiches or anything, stays to himself, is wonderful to everybody. Right? Not what you're thinking. You think he's going to show up in cowboy chaps. And right? When he's on camera, though, he can let loose a little bit. And I quickly realized, that's amazing. That ability to take a risk, to be seen and judged and criticized, and to go for it, I envied it. We'd all be better off with more of it. He's got sometimes too much of it, but what an asset to a movie. And it started hitting me, that's what makes good actors, the commitment, 100%. John Travolta is the same way. Right? The movies John Travolta's been in that we've seen that we loved him in, any actor could also just roll their eyes and say, this is stupid. But if you do the thing and you do it well, it's awesome. And you believe in it, and so we start to believe in it too. So doing something 100% all out is reaps rewards.
Now, you grew up in and around the entertainment industry. Your father was a talented comedy writer and producer, known for his work on That Was the Week That Was, The Carol Burnett Show, Sanford and Son, others. My wife loves the fact that your father created That Girl.
Yes.
Can you talk about what sparked your interest in filmmaking? Growing up in this environment, what did you learn early on that made you want to consider this work?
The first step to all of it is, I think, I saw Hollywood and show business as respectable, not the weirdos out in LA. This is a real thing. And I met awesome, interesting people who were succeeding in life and had families. Show business also is very appreciative and respectful to what has come before them, right? We honor what brought us to this point. So you watch old movies and old shows and learn from all that. And I loved that. I just thought the glamour was cool, and I was so non-cynical and idealistic. So I didn't see how much bullshit there was throughout all of it, right, at first. And then when you make someone laugh, oh my God, what a feeling. It's the greatest, especially if you're neurotic and a little narcissistic, okay? When you're insecure, that stuff's gold, right? So I don't care what other people think. I only care what other people think. Right? What else? Seriously, what else matters? What you think about yourself? Go sit on a mountain then. But if you're gonna be here with the rest of us, you better care what we think. Put on some cologne, please. So being around it and finding it amazing and realizing how hard it was, how hard my dad worked, how difficult the chore was, and how other people couldn't do that thing. I mean, you think, wow. That's a challenge, I want to do that. But I didn't really know what a movie director was or any of that stuff, right? I'd visit on the set of a sitcom and I'd be scared of the actors and I'd see the props and all that. I think it was great, and showbiz, but I was scared of all of it. I studied theater because I thought I'd be an actor because that I knew what that was. And then I went and saw, I thought directing a play is kind of what I'm doing anyway. When I was on stage in a play, I was doing A Man for All Seasons, right? I think you would know quite a lot about Sir Thomas More. I played Sir Thomas More. And when I was on stage playing this 63-year-old man when I was 18, that was a good play. I knew where the light was off, where the other actor wasn't standing where they were supposed to. It's very cold in here. And how come this part is laughing and there? And I was not in it. I was not Nick Caging this experience, right? I was outside kind of directing the whole thing while I was on stage, and I realized that's more my thing. And so I decided to go to film school. I didn't know anything about making movies, and I was good at it, you know, and I liked it. I was good at it. So I did it.
Tell us about some of your favorite films, the films that have influenced you in your own formation.
I think it started not just, look, the movies I liked when I was a kid were stupid kid movies. Like I didn't, as a 9-year-old, go, oh, Citizen Kane is amazing. Not like J.T. DeGioia, the weirdo. I liked War of the Gargantuas and, you know, James Bond movies and things like that. But I started to see other movies and, oh, wow, that was deep. That was interesting. That isn't what that was. That's a whole other thing. And the movies I started really liking weren't necessarily the kind of movies I made, right? I thought The Deer Hunter was the most extraordinary thing I'd ever seen. I was a teenager, late teenager when I saw it. But I also really loved Kramer versus Kramer, right? Very mainstream movie. And all the cool people thought I was a dork for liking that movie, right? But I did. And then I saw Singing in the Rain, and I thought, that is the most entertaining thing I have ever seen. And everything everyone was doing on screen was hard and extraordinary. I thought, wow, that is a high bar. So let's start doing that. And other movies, Broadcast News. When I saw Broadcast News, I was like, wow, that's writing. You know, that cleverness of that. There's a movie called Charade with Audrey Hepburn and Cary Grant. And I thought, this is so delightful. I'm falling in love with every single person in this film. And the writing, again, was so intricate. I thought, how do you do that? So the idea of doing all that hard stuff and the result of it is people are happier, people are laughing, and in my imagination, they were loving me for doing this, right? And then people pay you a lot of money.
You mentioned your undergraduate years. You went to Wesleyan, one of the great liberal arts colleges. What role did a liberal education play in your own?
Extraordinarily important, right? And we shouldn't, you know, all the, look, I tell people don't study film. Because if you study film, you have nothing to make a film about, right? Read, study history, read books, econ, right? Political science, get into the world, learn about the world, and now you have something to make movies about, and you understand behavior and you understand people, right? You're not gonna learn about people by being in a play. You're gonna learn about people by breaking up with someone and by getting fired from a job and all of that. All the classes I remember most were my classes not from my major, right? I really do wish there was a degree you could get called liberal arts, right? But you have to choose a major. Why can't your major be liberal arts, where you graduate knowing stuff about everything, right? Because that's really the thing when you go out in the world, right? You need to know about everything. Yes, when you graduate, you're 22 and a nobody, and you'll take any job you can get, and you're trying to figure out life, and it seems like all of that other stuff was a waste. But as you keep going, you're gonna keep re-encountering things in your life, and your astronomy class will suddenly show up when your kid asks you about the comet that just came by, right? You don't know where you're gonna need this, but you're gonna need it and love it and want it, and that, I think liberal arts education is the education everyone needs. But that's maybe unpopular because we're also in a mood where why don't we teach people how to be good at things and go beat the world at that thing, sure. Right? Sure. I don't know why we have to beat the world sure. at anything. We just have to do good.
I'm gonna open it up to the audience in a moment. Let me ask you one question as a transition as the microphone comes out. I mentioned earlier some of the philanthropic work that you and, mm-hmm. and your wife, Amy, are deeply involved in. I mentioned Creative Visions, which Amy and her mom founded in memory of her late brother, mm-hmm. Dan, the work you're all engaged in Kenya and Uganda. Can you talk a little bit about the nature of the work that you're engaged in and how it fits in your life?
Yeah, well, you know, my wife grew up in Kenya, right? I grew up in Beverly Hills. A little different. My parents, though, were very philanthropic. There was always something going on, a fundraiser, people at our house. So you learn quickly that that's not something also you do in life, that is life. That's part of being alive, is doing that. She grew up the same way. But it's hard to give to charities and do things that aren't around you. You've got to see it and feel it. And she grew up that way. I went to Kenya, spent time with her, and it was clear what, I mean, a million things you can do. At that time, it was an AIDS issue and AIDS orphans. And someone, her father was there, what they were thinking of, and they needed money, and let's start an orphanage for AIDS orphans. And bring them through a school. Now, the definition of AIDS orphan, though, is a little different. There's a lot of kids. Remember, these aren't kids with AIDS. These are kids whose parents died from it. But a lot of kids are not taken in. They're yucky because that person died. They hated that lady and all that stuff. So they get orphaned. Most kids often are absorbed in the community. Kenya is not a big orphanage country. You can't adopt babies from Kenya. They take care of the babies. But these kids had sometimes nowhere to go. And so we started a school and where the kids all lived, and there were 50 kids came through. This is already 18 years, so they're done. And it's weird because we sort of did a charity thing where you're done. You did it. You fixed it. It's over, right? And we're still following through, but there's college fees to pay and kids who can go to college and you follow up a little bit. But we got those kids through that. I got exposed through my wife to the child soldiers in Uganda. And you stay here and you go, oh, that's really bad. You go there and see it. You can't not do something. It's really bad. Like, you think of the worst things that could happen. It's really worse than that. So you get involved and you try to make a difference, and then you try to fight your way through the cynicism and the lying and the corruption and all of those things, and so many people stand in your way of doing good things in life. It's not gonna help, or oh, you're being fooled and all that stuff. It's complicated. And maybe you are getting ripped off at some point or something, right? Some warlord's taking your money and buying a car instead of food. That's not my problem. My problem is, am I the person who gives the money, right, or helps? So you just got to be that person. And...
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Are there members of the audience who'd like to ask a question? The microphone's right in the middle aisle, and if you'll approach the microphone, I'll call on you until we run out of time.
And how could there be questions? I said everything.
I think we've got somebody
perfectly.
We have somebody moving.
You can ask really cheesy Hollywood questions or really deep, really.
And please introduce yourself and your connection to the university.
Hi, my name is Tori Phillips, and I'm a member of the executive education team at the School of Business. First off, a little fangirl moment. I just want to say thank you for the National Treasure movies because they planted the seed that not only inspired my love for Washington, D.C. and history, but they also inspired me to eventually move to D.C. and call it my home, so thank you. I appreciate your charity work, and I was curious, what of your experiences as a director of film, of feature films and blockbusters, has impacted the work that you do in Africa? What have you learned that affects the charity that you execute?
On a very surface, it's not what you mean, but yeah, you make a good living, you got a way to help, right? And you feel it. You get that check and you're like, wow, you could do a lot of good with this check. I think two things. Making movies makes you hopefully better at communicating, right? You understand how to talk to people and convince people of things and change minds and tell stories as a way of doing that. But I also think, certainly for me, listening. Observing and listening and seeing details. You know, the best characters in movies and the best movies you see, they're real because of the details that blossom and take over the whole thing. And you look at people's lives and where they're living, and if you see those details, right, and you see that the more important part of this story is not the battles, but what's going on inside each of those kids and each of those soldiers and each of those people, you know, and I know it's true in a way from when you go to the movies, right? You are following that character and what she wants, and you immediately connect to that person because she's exposed herself or he's shared something vulnerable and you're in. And now you look at these people and it's not just the kid with the machine gun that you now see as a kid. It's also the warlord who gave him. He's got stuff going on too, right? And I may be able to stop him by shooting him in the face, or I may be able to stop him by getting him to become human again, right? And so you look for all of those solutions, right? And I would say that.
Hello, Robert Girardi. I'm a library associate, and I also write screenplays. I have one right here. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I do write screenplays. I don't have it. I'll call you later. But you know, my concern is that the era of going to the movies is over. You know, I actually have a part-time job selling movie tickets at a theater in Bethesda, and I can tell you, most nights it's empty. And I just wonder how much longer we're going to be open, and movie theaters in general, you know, the great tradition of the 20th century, going to the movies with all the people, and there it is. You know, how much longer is that going to obtain, and do you worry about this?
Let me ease your mind.
Yeah.
Stop worrying.
If only I could.
Because it's done. It's done. My opinion, but I'm always right. It is over. It will linger a little bit. It stopped. And things happen. Going to a movie and seeing a movie in theater is the greatest thing. But there are a lot of other really great things that are gone. And that's going to be one of them. And if you look around the room and you find some students, they're the ones who ruined it for you. I believe it's a truth that people will choose convenience over quality. That seems to be how we all are. And we are particularly in a state in this country, not just young, lazy, horrible people, but older, lazy, horrible people. We don't leave our house. We don't even like other people. Okay? So if someone gives you a chance to stay home and not be around anyone else, most people take it. So, and there's another side thing which I'm going to say, and there's no evidence of this either. But the movie business was driven in a large part by women. Okay? That old thing of, I want to get out of the house, take me out. If you want to date me, we got to go somewhere. I want to get to know you. Women work. They're tired at the end of the day. They want to stay home. And Netflix and chill came along. And when a young woman says, I don't want to go out, let's stay home on my couch, make out, watch my TV that I'm paying for and the subscription service I'm paying for, every single man goes, okie dokie. Okay? Women gave men the out to not have to go out anymore. So the culture changed. And your cell phone is where people live. That's it. We're done. I hate to say it. It's done.
Doesn't that diminish the art form? I mean, the...
Totally.
You know.
It's horrible.
Watching Gone with the Wind on your phone. I mean, but...
Horrible.
Thank you.
Right, now I'm going to go cry.
It's done.
I hope you'll be able to answer the next question
a little
with a little more hopefulness.
Next guy's going to say, I really like opera.
Please.
Thank you for speaking with us today, Mr. Turteltaub. You said earlier that what makes us like a story is when there are high stakes and when the stakes are intense. Can you name your favorite or the best three political films of all time?
Okay. You know, first of all, we have to draw a big line between best and favorite, right? And we all know that's not the same thing, yet we confuse it all the time. Especially when you read a review, you're reading a review of what someone liked, not what is, okay? Or else every movie would get the exact same review, right? And every person would date the exact same people, and that's what it is. It's not how it works. Political movies. You know what I saw again recently? It was 3 Days of the Condor, okay? You probably haven't heard of it. You probably should. It's definitely dated from its era, but that's what makes it great. You get to travel in time to see what that era was like of movie making and of life in New York City in the early 70s, right? 3 Days of the Condor, Robert Redford, amazing. Political movies. Citizen Kane is a politics movie, and not a lot of people count it. And if you think a movie from the 30s, doesn't matter today. There's a scene in Citizen Kane where this awful, obnoxious tycoon is running for governor of the state. His campaign is that the current governor and his opponent, the first thing he's going to do is put him in jail. And the next thing he's going to do is change the whole system and get rid of everybody. And then you cut to the newspaper he runs at the end of the night, and they have a newspaper printed already that says, Kane wins. And the guy next to him says, what if he doesn't win? And he holds up the other newspaper they have called and says, election rigged. Okay. I'll also point out that President Trump said Citizen Kane was his favorite movie. Okay? And why that actually I don't think is that significant is I don't think you ever saw it, to tell the truth. Just everyone says that. So certainly All the President's Men is a great movie. Parallax View is a very interesting movie. It's political as well. I'm sure I'm forgetting other things, but start with that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Please.
Hey, good evening. My name is Andrew. I'm a graduate student. Another fanboy moment. It was a piece you produced, but like I think it was second or third grade, watched VHS of Rocket Man and wrote my first.
wrote terrible, by the way.
For a third grader, it was very clever. And wrote I pretty much plagiarized it and wrote a story about it. And that
talking about his favorite scene is when the astronaut farts in his suit and it blows up. Okay, that's a big, big comedic moment. Yes or no?
Big time. I'm writer director. Just a question about kind of earlier career. Obviously, you punched up like on a lot of your stuff from, you know, budget to what you produce. Can you talk through like some of those creative decisions that you had to make on a shorter budget, smaller budget, and with like a crew who may not have been paid, who've been paid scale and stuff like that?
Nothing. I've done those movies too. You know, the good news is, I think this isn't back to Orson Welles' quote, it's something like a lack of restrictions is the death of an artist. You can't create with no restrictions. And we all claim, I want more freedom, I need all more money, I want to do all this. The blank page is impossible, right? A blank canvas. Thank God a canvas has borders, right? Those restrictions guide you and push you in a direction. And when you're stuck, rely on the restrictions, because what an obstacle in life gives you is a chance to be a hero, right? When something goes wrong, and it's not your fault, the only option available is for you to be a freaking hero and save the day. So you endeavor with joy to overcome that stuff. And the victory is sweeter. You've got to work within the world you have, what you've got, bottom line. So if you only have this much money, don't spend more than that. You don't have it. But create something that will fit in there. And we've all seen that it's look, you guys are already too old for Vines, too young for Vines, but even, and TikToks as well. There are brilliant TikToks, 15 seconds, 30 seconds, and it's awesome. You can tell a story and get a great response and an emotional response in that. And it's shot on someone's phone in their mom's kitchen, right? Those restrictions get bigger when you're trying from the start to go beyond them, right? Use your restrictions, you know, make them positives for you. So if all you got is two friends and one of them's really tall, you should probably write a script for a really tall guy, right?
Thanks very much. That was pretty hopeful.
That was better than the others.
That was pretty hopeful. We have time for one more. I'm so
one
sorry.
More.
I'm so sorry for those.
You're all doomed.
But let me
another opportunity to be hopeful. I'll
sure.
do my best. I'm Taylor. I'm a recent Georgetown grad. I grew up watching National Treasure with my dad every single time I'm ever home. We still do it. And we just finished the new TV show. And I'm curious what the process was like after you finished the first one and decided to make a second one, to think about expanding the franchise universe and then how you're thinking about the future of the films.
You know, when you finish it, you think it's good, but you don't know. Sometimes you think it's bad, but you don't know. And then the audience tells you, right? And on that one, in spite of what everyone told us before we made the movie, and despite the misery it was making the movie, the audience said, great, we loved it. That doesn't come along very often in the movie business. So when you've got that, you hang on to it. And you think, is there more for this character? Are there more for these people? Is there more to do? Yeah, there is. So let's do it again, right? And yes, business decision. It's a smart business decision, right? So you do it again. And you celebrate and you feel awesome about yourself, right? Because you think you did great and everyone loves you and you're a winner. I did a movie called The Meg about a giant shark. I mean, and the night it came out, early that afternoon, we got a bunch of phone calls from studios and people who know and said, the movie's dead, bombed. It might gross $15 million. But good job, you tried your best, it's fine. So that weekend, it made $47 million. Okay? But my wife and I were doing the, hey, our kids are healthy, we love each other, all that stuff, right? And then when it made the money, it was like, let's go to Vegas. You celebrate your wins, and you need to in your life. Celebrate those wins, right? Don't just go. Don't feel bad about them. Celebrate it and enjoy it, because there aren't a lot of them. There really aren't. I don't know if that was the answer to the question you were looking for. It wasn't.
I mean, that's good. Anything you can tell us about the third movie would be awesome.
Ooh. No. let me see. Yes. Look, there's a script. It's a good script. It's not a great script. But there's some things in it that are really good. There are scenes in Washington, D.C. The cast expands a little bit, contracts a little bit. The main people are all in it. And it might involve New Orleans at some point. And I shouldn't have said that, but there you go.
Well, I have family there, so that was
You have family there?
Yeah.
Great, I'll look for them when I go.
Thanks so much. John, thank you for taking
this awesome.
Time with us this evening. I hope.
How did I do, Peter?
This is...
I'm no Robert Gates, we know.
This is pure joy for all of us, and I can't thank you enough for being here. And let me now turn it over back to Dean Hamasi, who will close our gathering this evening.
We have 10 minutes for you to get off stage.
I'll get a running start.
Thank you so much. What a pleasant evening, what a funny evening, what an inspiring evening, and moving. The honesty and the openness, even though occasionally I do read a few books. We are very pleased to have you here, and thank you, President DeGioia. Please join me in thanking you. I hope you've had a great time, and wish you a very happy evening. Thank you.